Good to see you today. I hope you have your Bibles with you today, and you'll find with me Matthew chapter 5. We're going to wrap up our time together in Romans chapter 12 today, so if you were to go by there, just stick your finger, put a pencil or something in that, and we'll sort of wrap up our time together today in Romans chapter 12. I want to encourage you today. What an amazing opportunity we had to hear our youth. And I appreciate so much you guys taking the opportunity to speak to us and encourage us by what God was doing in your life. And I appreciate that so very much. You know, sometimes we don't think about the investment that's made. We've got a round number of what it costs to send our youth to camp this year. We were right at $30,000 to send our youth to camp. Do you realize that the parents, Amanda, correct me, but I think you all paid $100. You all took care of the rest. And so you're to be commended. I want to say thank you for the opportunity to make that happen, and I believe it's an investment worth being made. And so I thank you for your time and your energy and your investment into the life of the youth. This morning we open up and continue our journey in the Beatitudes and talk about a subject matter that I think that all of us to some level have an opportunity to be able to connect with. Maybe not necessarily in the best of ways. Sometimes we may find ourselves in the Word of God to allow the Word to, when it looks into our hearts, that sometimes it's not a pat on the back. Sometimes it's a tug at the heart. Sometimes it's an opportunity to bring conviction. And I think this passage this morning, not only for myself, but maybe for some of us as well, this is one of those passages that really tugs at our hearts. I think it's the way God uses His Word to be able to do surgery on our life, to be able to help us to become like His Son. With your Bibles open and also with your notes today, I want to start this morning with the words that's on the top of your notes this morning, just as a opportunity to remind us of the world that we find ourselves living in today. The scripture, our note says this morning, war is one of the constants of history and has not diminished with the civilization and with democracy. In the last 3,421 years of recorded history, that's how many years we have recorded history, out of those 3,400 years, only 268 years have seen no war. That's a chilling statement. And it would no doubt even be more so if the facts of the unrecorded history could be known, that history that was beyond our record keeping. While war is a constant among nations, so is the relentless conflicts that happens among friends, among families, and acquaintances. And the solution is, maybe the solution needs to be asked this way, or is there a solution? What we do know is this, that conflict is inevitable. We live in a fallen world. Conflict can and will happen. More times than we would like to admit, we've seen where conflict has happened in our homes, in our families, and even sometimes in our churches. There are no perfect people in this world, and it's the imperfection of people that actually brings us to the place of conflict to begin with. James says it this way in James chapter 4 as he seeks to answer the question, where does conflict come from to begin with? And he says it this way, what causes fights and quarrels among you? Verse 1, James chapter 4 verse 1, do they not come from the desires that battle within yourself? Eugene Peterson in his message paraphrase restates this, and I love the message paraphrase because it has a way to sort of speak very candidly to the issue. And this is what he says, where do you think all these appalling wars and quarrels come from? Do they just happen? Think again, he says. They come about because you want your own way and fight for it deep inside of yourselves. When we look back into our homes and our families, and we've had many opportunities through the years to be able to talk with families about the conflicts, and sometimes as pastors we're called upon to do that. And what we continue to hear the opportunities being is that we find difficulties within families and within churches and with all around us. We find ourselves in a position where that we're longing to be able to pull together or try to find a way for resolution, but yet we have two opposing sides that are determined at the end of the day that they feel their way is the best way. And sometimes we find these conflicts not getting to the place where they ever find resolution, and unresolved conflict brings about within our families and when people all around us, that becomes very painful, and sometimes it can be debilitating. And oftentimes we even find that same unresolved conflict inside of churches. Where do rumors happen? What happens inside of churches sometimes? Where rumors rumble, people tend to take sides, and discouragement then sets in, and the body of Christ then becomes very unhealthy, and the local community around us takes notice that in reality the church is no different than the rest of the world. But what would happen if the church decided that rather than holding a grudge, that we find a way to dig in, rather than being part of the problem, that we would rather decide to look at conflict through the lens of being a peacemaker? Ken Sandy, in his book, The Peacemaker, A Biblical Guide to Resolving Personal Conflict, writes these words: peacemakers are people who breathe grace. They draw continually on the goodness and the power of Christ within them, and they bring His love, mercy, forgiveness, strength, and wisdom to the conflicts that happen in daily life. God delights to breathe grace through peacemakers and use them to dissipate anger, improve understanding, promote justice, and encourage repentance and reconciliation. A few years ago, George Gallup actually did a poll of the top five questions that people would like to ask God when at somewhere along this journey of life. And one of those top five questions was this: will there ever be lasting world peace? If you were to watch any Miss America pageant, what you'll find that at the end of the day, we're all looking for world peace, but is it even possible? Living in a broken and fallen world that we live in, is it even possible? It was President Eisenhower that once said, "We have become a race of intellectual giants and moral pygmies. Despite our great technological advances, we continue to devise more ways and more efficient means of killing each other." Will there ever be peace? Well, the scripture says that the Bible is a book of peace, and he tells us in within scripture over 400 times as he talks about peace, such as Luke chapter 2, as Jesus was born in verse 14, the angels saying, "Peace on earth, goodwill toward men." John chapter 14, verse 27, as Jesus was addressing his disciples the night before the crucifixion, he said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you." Paul challenged the church, and Paul challenges us in Ephesians 2:14 that he, Christ, himself is our peace. And Solomon writes to us and encourages us in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 8, there's a time for war, and ultimately there's a time for peace. It was in 1983, in October of that year, Psychology Today actually also did a survey and asked this intriguing question: if you could find a machine that had a push button, and therefore that push button would eliminate any person with no repercussions to yourself, would you push the button? Over 60% of those who responded said they would be glad to push the button. The problem is, if there was such a device invented, how long would it be for the human race to cease existence? The scripture says to us in this passage in Matthew chapter 5, "Blessed are the peacemakers," verse 9, "for they shall be called the sons of God." I believe it would be helpful this morning for us to do a little study of what the words actually mean. And the scripture speaks a lot about peace, and the reality is so many times we think about peace as being that which, when we find ourselves that's in the absence of war or absence of conflict or absence of chaos. But reality is, peace in the Bible is never to be confused with a sense of pacifism or peace at any price. It was Andy Rooney that I remember reading about. Some of you who have a little bit of age on us remember that name. But Andy Rooney was recollecting his education at Colgate University in the years just preceding World War II. And he recalled hearing one of his philosophy teachers argue strenuously that any peace is better than at any war. Rooney said at first he bought into that idea, but years later he discovered how false it was when he visited the Holocaust Museum at Buchenwald for the very first time. He responded, some things are worth fighting for and some things are worth fighting against. But the reality is, peace is not this drug-induced society of this sort of false tranquility that comes from some kind of drug, marijuana, cocaine, or whiskey, or whatever it may be. The reality is that's not peace. It's simply a drug-induced stupor that allows us to temporarily check out for just a moment. Yet the peace in the Bible, that broad term, gives to us an understanding that it has to do something with much deeper than that. We turn first of all to the Old Testament idea of the word peace, and it uses the word shalom. That's our fill in the blank. It uses the word shalom that speaks about a sense of peace or completeness, a sense of soundness or welfare. When you see the word shalom used in Scripture, it means you're wishing someone not the absence of war, but the full presence of peace and prosperity and all the blessings of God. We find it used oftentimes in the Psalms, as the psalmist would write, and he would contemplate a matter, and then he would tell us shalom. And the idea is that we would pause and rest and think, that allow the word of God to sink deep into our hearts. Psalm 46 is one of those passages just prior to verse 10, as he would remind us, just be still and know that I'm God. And the fact that we need to remember and recollect and understand that the sufficiency of all of our life rests upon the fact that God is ever present within us. We see that word used wonderfully in Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 and 5, as the Aaronic blessing, and we'll sort of wrap up our service today with that worship set. And that blessing simply goes this way, and you know it very well. The Lord bless you, and the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. It's important and imperative for us to remember that the Bible is always, that in the Bible, peace in the Bible is always based upon justice and righteousness. And where justice and righteousness rules, there is peace. When there's an absence of either of these, there is conflict. We live in a fallen and a broken world. We continually find opportunities all around us where conflict is ever present among us. When we bring ourselves to the New Testament, we find a different word that's used there. Obviously, Old Testament was written in Hebrew. New Testament was written in the Greek, in Koine Greek. The Greek word that we find for the peace in the New Testament is the word Irene, or where we get our name Irene from. So if you've got a friend named Irene somewhere along the way, you can tell her that her name simply means peace. When you see the Greek word used for peace, what you find the usage is not so much speaking of the absence of conflict. On the contrary, peace in the New Testament oftentimes depicts a sense of inner peace that's found in the midst of the conflict or the storm that's going on around us. Just like it was wonderfully stated in John 14. You know the context of that passage. John 14, what's getting ready to happen to the world around Jesus? They're getting ready to find his absence coming soon. By the time the next morning happens, he's going to be up on a cross being crucified. And he tells his disciples in John 14, let not your hearts be what? You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'm going to come again and receive you myself. Thomas said, well, my goodness, where are you going? And Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man comes to the Father except through me. No, the reality is we cannot know peace apart from a relationship with Jesus Christ. But further beyond that, Jesus is going to say to his disciples, it's better for me to go away than it is for me to remain. Why? Wouldn't we want Jesus to hang out a while? The reality was, if Jesus hung out a while and he was still here in our society today, Jesus might be over in Israel and we're still stuck over here. He's in one place at one time. Jesus says, if I go away, I'm going to send someone to you. John chapter 14, verse 25. I'm telling you these things while I'm still with you. I know you may want me to stay here, but it's going to be far better for me to go away. Verse 26, but when the Father sends the Advocate as my representative, that is the Holy Spirit, he will teach you everything and remind you of everything that I have told you. I'm leaving you with this gift. And this gift is the peace of mind and of heart. And the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. It don't even understand. So don't be troubled or afraid. Why? Because I'm depositing, as I leave, the Spirit of God inside of you, and the Spirit of God's going to be able to empower you and enable you to understand something that previously you've never been able to understand, because it's through the power of the Spirit that we're allowed to understand peace anyway. Isn't that what the fruit of the Spirit is? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, what? Apart from the Spirit of God living in us, apart from Him bearing fruit in our life, we'll never be able to understand peace in our life. And so when we see this New Testament concept of the word peace, it speaks specifically and more often about peace in the midst of conflict, not peace in the absence of conflict. Something on the inside is finding its resolve, it's finding its tranquility, it's finding its acceptance, it's finding its peace in the midst of conflict and chaos going on around us. And sometimes we hear people saying, I just don't have any peace. It's likely saying something more about themselves than it is the circumstances that's going on around them. Because as followers of Jesus Christ, we have been given the awesome privilege to be able to understand peace, because Christ, through the Spirit, lives within us. But the application of this is very clear. Blessed are the peace, what? Makers. Those who make peace. Those who promote peace. Those who are about helping to facilitate what God has established and called us as individuals to do. The reality is we live in a world that's full of conflict. Whether it's in America with just the conflict that we have between nationalities and races and all the rest, we as followers of Christ have been called to lean into those conflicts and be peacemakers. If we were to go to India, we would find in India that one state would never marry people from another state because there's such tension between the two. There's obvious tension. Hindus and Muslims distrust each other, and which translates into tension between India and Pakistan. There's a need in our world today for marital and family reconciliation. Think how many divorced people in our world that we know of that have struggled through the throes of divorce and find themselves and ultimately families around them being wounded and scarred by the pain of a broken relationship. Children rebel, and oftentimes they run away because they can't stand the fighting, the anger, the rejection, and ultimately the pressure and the abuse that may come. Think about the call for reconciliation in the workplace between labor and management, owners and workers and bosses and employees. The divisions even in the Christian church. So many different Protestant denominations. Do you realize how many Baptist, different kind of Baptist churches there are in America? There's over 100 specific different kind of Baptist churches in America. Why? I remember hearing a story years ago that was about a guy who had been stranded on an abandoned island. He was there all by himself, and he'd been there for a few years, and while he was there, all of a sudden, after he was there for a while, there was a sailor that came by and sailed up to the island, noticed there was some inhabitants on the island, and he decided to pull in, found the young man that had been there for years, and he looked over to one side of the island and recognized there was a little building that had been built on the one side of the island, and he asked the man and said, curious as to what the building is. Is this your house? He said, no, that's the First Baptist Church. He said, okay, I'm glad to know that you had church. You're sort of all by yourself, so you're here by yourself, and there's nobody else. He said, that's right. I'm here all by myself, but that we built First Baptist Church there. That's good. He said, I noticed all as I was sailing up, there's also another little building on this other side. And he said, oh, yes, that was Second Baptist Church. And he said, why is there a Second Baptist Church? He said, we couldn't get along in First Baptist Church, so we started another one. And I know that's comical, but the reality is it's so true among us, is it not? We've got a call from God, a specific and a candid and a very directed call from God as followers of Christ to be peacemakers in this world. We're so quick to be able to choose sides. We're so quick to be able to throw in our 2 cents worth. We're so quick to find ourselves in this world not to follow the simple admonitions of Scripture. You know, Ephesians 4 says to us that let no corrupt communication come out of your mouth, but only such as is good for the building of the body. What does that say? If we can't say anything good, we ought not to say anything at all. And yet we find ourselves in this culture feeling as though we've got to find a way to continue the process. And that flies in the face of what God has called us as followers of Christ to do, to be peacemakers. Not division makers, but peacemakers. Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, you know that passage well. I'm going to read it out of the Message paraphrase once again. I feel like it's helpful for me to sometimes grasp the truth of it. But listen to what Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5, verses 16 and following. Because of this decision, we no longer evaluate people by what they have or how they look. We looked at the Messiah that way once and we got it all wrong. Paul speaking honestly and candidly about himself. You know, he was one who actually was a persecutor of those of the way. And he said, we certainly don't look at him that way anymore. Rather, we now look inside and see, and what we see is anyone that's united with the Messiah gets a fresh start. He's created brand new. The old life is gone, a new life emerges. Look at it. All this comes from God who settled the relationship between us and him. And then has called us to settle our relationships with each other. God put the world square with himself up through the Messiah, giving the world a fresh start by offering forgiveness of sins. God has given us the task of telling everyone what he's doing. We're Christ representatives or ambassadors. God uses us to persuade men and women to drop their differences and enter into God's work of making things right between them. We're speaking for Christ himself now. Become friends with God. He's already a friend with you. How, you ask? In Christ. How? Because God put the wrong on him who never did anything wrong so we could be right with God. So we've got something about the words. We've got a little idea about application. Let's talk about quickly the reward, reflecting on the reward. There's a reward, as there has been in every one of these Beatitudes, a response, a natural response. And in this one he says, those who are peacemakers shall be called the sons and daughters of God. Perhaps maybe a little illustration might help to understand this. I had the privilege of growing up in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. That was where my home was. I had the privilege of being born as the youngest child to a couple that was what most people would consider to be elderly. My dad was 58 when I was born. We oftentimes found ourselves, as dad retired, and I found myself sort of his little buddy to go with him everywhere we went, and he had retired. He was a bivocational pastor in Lexington, North Carolina, a little small independent Baptist church, and he was also an electrician at R.J. Reynolds Tobacco Company. We would often run into people along the way. Dad had a lot of influence. There were a lot of people that knew him, even in a town as large as Winston-Salem. And I would hear people say something along these lines. You're the son of Mark Myers. Yeah. heard those words many times in my life, and in those days, I don't know that I ever thought much about those terms, but as I've grown, as I've aged, I've thought a lot more about them. Today, I've got four children of my own, Mark, Paul, Sarah, and Grace. And each one of them finds themselves a little bit of me inside of them. I hope it's the best sides. But you may ask today, and I may think about this. Today, still, I may run into someone that knew my dad. There's not many of those folks left these days. But once in a while, you'll still run across someone, and they'll say, "You're Mark's son, aren't you?" And I'm proud to be called that. The reality is, I bear the mark of my father in me. My children bear the mark of their father within them. And there's no place that we will ever find the mark of our Heavenly Father in us anymore than when we find ourselves being makers of peace. Romans 8:29 says this, "For God knew his people in advance, and he chose us to be like his son, so that his son might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters." And the promise of this beatitude is simply this: as we are peacemakers in the world, we resemble our Heavenly Father and his son. Let's make some application, if I can, this morning. You know, I think about this thing of peace, and it's a difficult matter at times, and we find ourselves continually bombarded with these opportunities and challenges that are before us because we live in a world that's filled with conflict. But as I've chewed in my own life over the last several weeks and months, really, even in preparing for this series, I there's some things that I personally have done, and I sort of challenge us all as I have looked at myself and as I will continue to, because I'm still an imperfect person, and I need to make some changes as well. But let me say this, I think I need to be reminded that if we're going to have peace, if we're going to be a peacemaker, we must first have peace with God, and we must also have the peace, the second fill in the blank is of God living within us. We can never take anyone anywhere where we've not been ourselves. I remember Kermit Sims many times talking about somewhere he's traveled throughout the country, and he could tell you what roads to take in so many places. It was amazing the way, you know, this little hometown boy from Haines City, Florida, he seemed like he knew where to go, how to get anywhere in the country. But he had been in most of those places, and he knew how to get there. We'll never be able to tell anybody how to go where we've not been ourselves. So you need to know, if we're going to be a peacemaker, we've got to have peace with God. That's salvation. You've got to know Christ as your personal Savior. And we've got to have the peace of God living in us. The fruit of the Spirit has to be evident in our life in order for us to be peacemakers. So there's got to be a salvation experience, and there's got to be a continual ongoing relationship in our life with Him. Secondly, as we're called to be peacemakers, I think we must first look inwardly and examine ourselves rather than judging others. It's so easy for us to look at other people. We can tell other people about the wrong. My wife can tell you every fault I have. She never will, but she could. You know, it's so obvious. Sometimes those things are so obvious in other people's lives, but God's never called us to judge other people. He's called us to first judge ourselves. And if we're going to be a peacemaker, we're going to have to be honest with ourselves of where we are, where our faults are, where we need to grow, and where we need to develop. If we're going to be peacemakers, we're going to have to be growing ourselves. We're going to have to be challenged ourselves. We're going to have to examine ourselves. Thirdly, I believe if we're going to be a peacemaker, we're going to have to learn to listen intently. That's hard for us to do. So many times in families, they've come and they're having all kinds of challenges that may come their way, and the difficulties that may come, and all of a sudden we find ourselves, you know, they'll husband and wife will say, he said this, she said this, and at the end of the day, really their screams at each other is really about personal assault. They're talking not about the issue, they're talking about each other. And if somewhere along the line someone had just paused long enough to listen to what was being said, I wonder if we could have avoided a lot of conflicts along the journey of life. God's called us, I believe, God's given us one mouth and two ears for a purpose. We ought to listen carefully. Number four, I believe God, if we're going to be peacemakers, we're going to have to affirm the thoughts and feelings of other people. Paul said in Philippians chapter 2, we need to look on the interest of others more than we look on the interest of ourselves. What this simply means is we need to find a way to value the feelings and thoughts of other people. And the reality is we need to do that. We need to accept that. We need to listen. We need to value what people have to say. Number five, I think five, we need to choose to forgive even if we've never been asked to. That may be the more difficult thing for us in this journey, because God's told us our forgiveness is dependent upon our willingness to forgive. Is that not true? If we refuse to forgive others, what does he say? Don't expect me to forgive your sins. Some of us might say, but the person I'm struggling with has died. He or she's deceased. How can we ever make things right? You may not be able to have an opportunity for an apology from someone, but God's never asked you to forgive them based upon an apology. God simply told us to forgive. Release the individual from the opportunity and the obligation. And lastly, while you're turning your Bibles to Romans chapter 12, I'd like to say we're going to learn the principles of Romans 12:18. But while you're finding in your Bibles, let me tell you a little story in wrapping our time up today. About 700 years ago, there was a young man born. He was born to an Italian cloth merchant, and he was destined to be a knight. A man of great wealth and fame. Instead, he chose to wear a cloak tied around with a rope that he had borrowed off of a scarecrow. He spent his days preaching and giving to others, and he chose to live in utter poverty. History records that there was a man who history would tell us was noble, and kind, and humble. Christ-like, one of the greatest Christians who've ever lived, and we know him today as St. Francis of Assisi. Centuries after his death, someone has translated one of his prayers into English and has set it to words, set it to music. And we may even recognize the words of his prayer, and it goes something like this. Lord, make me an instrument of peace. Where there's hatred, let me so love. Where there's injury, pardon. Where there's doubt, faith. Where there's despair, hope. Where there's darkness, light. Where there's sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, it is in dying that we are born to life everlasting. Romans chapter 12 gives to us, starting in verse 9 of my Bible, is a new section. Many of those sections are marked, maybe with your Bible, have some kind of notation above it. It's not part of the inspired scripture, but it oftentimes gives us a little bit of an idea of what we're about to read. And in my Bible, the ESV Bible actually states this way, the marks of a true Christian, over verse 9. Listen carefully to the words that Paul writes. Remember, Paul's already said, if we're going to find our life in this world, we're going to have to learn to give our lives as a living sacrifice. For it's not to be conformed to this world, but rather transformed by the renewing of our And if God's gift of grace is then poured into us, the fruit of that grace poured into us is going to be lived out in verses 9 and following. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing grace and showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal, but be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with each other. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all men. In verse 18, if it is possible, so far as it depends upon you. You know, when we read Scripture, so oftentimes we want to look at a passage of Scripture and say, ha, that's my trigger, that's the way out. I've got a limit here. You know, I can work, I can do this, and here's my way out. This is not the intention of this verse. The intention of this verse is to remind us of our personal responsibility with everything that's within us. How does that verse end? Live at peace with all men or everyone. We're called to be peacemakers. Is there conflict in our world? More than we would like to admit. Do we find ourselves sometimes facing conflict that we don't like? Absolutely. Do we find ourselves at times in situations that we'd rather not be? Absolutely. But God has given to every one of us a responsibility. And there may be times in life that, at least for this season, that there's no possibility for peace. You've done what you could. But the reality is, God's called us, at the core of our being, to be peacemakers. And in so doing, we reflect the image of His Son and our Savior. Let's pray. Father, we do thank You for the privilege that we have today in this life to be able to open up Your Word and to be reminded of the things therein that oftentimes challenge us at our core. Difficult words sometimes we're called to live by. Maybe words that are impossible for us to live by, and that's okay. The reality is You've called us to live a life as a follower of Christ that is more difficult than sometimes we're able to do. I appreciate these youth today and the transparency of them. I appreciate Abby's brokenness this morning. What an encouragement to us all to be reminded that truly, God, You accept us as we are. And I'm so grateful for that. But God, help us never to be satisfied with where we are. Help us to always seek to grow, to become like Your Son. And may we find ourselves for the rest of our lives doing all that we can to grow up and to become the man and woman that You've called us to be. God, You've got a plan destined for every one of us. Help us not to stand in the way. Help us not to quench the Spirit, but help us to be a part of seeing what You would do in our lives to grow us up. And sometimes that may require us to address some things in our lives that needs to be addressed. God, call us not to accept where we are, but call us out to be peacemakers in the world that You've called us to live in. And we'll thank You for that in Jesus' name. Amen.